Warning, Sunday is not coming. Sunday is here. And I hope you can see the sun peeking right up over my shoulder. Happy Easter to all our friends and our family at Christ United Methodist Church. Reverend Jesse Smith and I welcome you this Easter Sunday morning to worship. First of all, I hope you guys take a few minutes and scroll down and greet one another on our Facebook page, and also write any joys or concerns that you may have so that we can celebrate with you and pray for you in this upcoming week. A few announcements this morning. Kids, stay tuned. Right after church this morning, we're going to have a virtual Easter egg hunt. I so missed being with you last week on our traditional Palm Fun Day for our egg hunt. So we will hunt eggs virtually right after church. There will be 10 eggs in each picture, and comment when you found them all. Also, the best way for you all to keep up to date with our information is for you to like our Facebook pages and also to check our website, xumc.org. And so now let's worship. Oh, happy day.
Father God, we come to sing to you this morning about the celebration of Easter and what that means to us as Christians. And you have conquered the grave, you've defeated death. Pain will last no more when we come to see your face and rise with you. God, we love you so much. Rescue me, sing it out, Jesus is alive. The empty cross, the empty grave, life eternal, you have won the day. Shout it out, Jesus is alive. He's alive.
Happy day, you wash my sin away. Oh, happy day.
I hope that you've had time to write some joys on our Facebook page so that we can share joys with you this morning. But I wanted to call out a few of those joys that I know that happened this week. First of all, we made 800 sandwiches for our homeless friends and neighbors at the Urban Ministry Center. Our team continued to deliver meals to our friends in Belhaven Estates. And Don and Maddie Sedgwick worked on a project this week taking photos that is going to mean a lot of food for hungry people at the Thrift United Methodist Food Pantry. So we celebrate that. And the last thing that I know about is several members did a lot of work in Reverend Ken Horn and Peggy's yard this week. And I know that brought them a lot of joy. I hope also that you have had time to write some concerns down and know that your church staff and your church community is praying for you about those concerns. So pray with me now. Almighty God, it is you who is the giver of life. And so we thank you and praise you for the offer of new life that is given to us on this day of resurrection. We thank you and praise you that even when things are hard, we see evidence of your goodness and joy. Thank you, God, for sandwiches and photos, for helping hands, and most of all, the hope of a new life that comes from an empty tomb. Lord, today we celebrate a little differently, but yet we celebrate. We pray for your presence for all those in the community and the world who are feeling isolated and alone today. May your church reach out with calls and letters of encouragement. We also pray for all of those who work tirelessly during this time, for those who make sure others have food to eat, for those who protect our community, and for those who care for the sick. We lift up the needs of this community, for those who are hungry or homeless, for those without hope, and the needs of the world. May your church continue to share the message of hope and resurrection and work for your kingdom to be made known here on earth. Hear us now, O Lord, as we raise our voices as one to pray the prayer that Jesus, our Lord and Savior, taught us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done,
on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses,
as we forgive those who trespass against us.
And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil.
Thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever.
Amen.
Good morning, children of Christ United Methodist Church. Today is Easter. I hope everyone's having a wonderful Easter this morning. Today we're going to go on a little virtual Easter egg hunt, and then we'll talk about the resurrection story. You ready? Come on, let's go.
Okay, this one has a leaf.
Oh, it's a palm leaf. This represents when Jesus was walking into Jerusalem, all the people welcomed him by waving palms like this.
Next one is yellow. It has a bread. That looks good, but it's chicken. And then a cup.
Yep, here's bread and a cup, and that represents the day that Jesus supped with his disciples, knowing that this was their last supper, and that he wanted everyone to take bread and wine in remembrance of him.
Yep. And next, it is orange, of coins.
Coins. These coins represent the three pieces of silver that Judas betrayed Jesus with. He turned Jesus into the Roman soldiers to be crucified.
Next one is a reddish pink. And there's a cross.
This cross represents when Jesus was crucified. He had to carry a very heavy cross up to the mountain, and he died there so that our sins are to be forgiven.
The next one, blue. Okay. Next, it has cloth.
Yep. This piece of cloth represents when Jesus died, he was wrapped in cloth and then placed inside of a tomb. And he was wrapped in this cloth by his friends, the people that loved him.
The next one is hot pink and the broken one. Next is a rock.
This stone represents the big stone that sealed Jesus' tomb so that no one could remove his body.
Next one is pink. Purple. Looks pink. Okay. There's nothing.
It's empty. This empty egg represents 3 days later when Jesus is risen and the tomb was empty. Thank you for listening. Happy Easter.
At this time, I would like to invite the ushers to come forward to receive today's tithes and offerings so that we can continue to do the great work that God has put on our hearts to do as a community, even while we are socially distant. And since you cannot give directly into these plates like you normally do, we want to encourage you to give online going to xumc.org/give. Or by mailing your checks to 8020 Bellhaven Boulevard. We thank you for your continued generosity to further the work of Christ in this community. Let's pray. Gracious God, we thank you for who you are. God, we thank you for the opportunity to give back a portion of what we've been blessed with so that we might impact the lives of others. It's in your name we pray. Amen.
God, we come today as a church to sing these truths about your Son, the risen one, the King, our Messiah. So we thank you and we sing this to you. As one body, we lift us up to the world. Your life. In Christ as dying, Christ is risen. Christ will come again. And Christ has died in. Christ is risen. And Christ will come again. Let's sing that together. Christ. Christ will come again. So turn your eyes upon Jesus. Look full in His wonderful face. In the things of earth will grow strangely dim in the light of His glory. Christ is risen, Christ will come again. So God, we thank You for those simple truths, that You sent Your Son to die, but He rose 3 days later and He's coming again. And we thank You for that victory. We love You so much. In Your name we pray.
Hey, Christ UMC, this is my first Easter Sunday here at the church. And man, y'all celebrate Easter different than anybody else I've ever been a part of. Usually the church pews are full and here we are. I'm trying to make light of what is a difficult situation. Maybe you're a little like me. I had some adrenaline at the beginning of this thing and sheltering in place, but I feel my adrenaline waning. I feel like there are times where I'm a little more irritable or on edge, and I've been trying to practice some healthy habits to keep that at bay, but it still feels like, when are things going to return to normal? It just seems like everything is discombobulated and upside down, and I just need gravity to pull things back into their right place. You know, this whole week I've been thinking about all the people that sat around in boardrooms, people in businesses and nonprofits, churches and charities, had all their staff members around these boardroom tables, big whiteboard, and they began dreaming dreams for what 2020 was going to look like. Maybe they crafted a 2020 vision statement or a task force to achieve some kind of objective in their organization. And they made their best laid plans. And they began to communicate that throughout the organization, and they redirected funds towards that end. Maybe they even had analysts in the background looking at the numbers and trying to see whether they were staying on track with their objective. And then in the beginning of 2020, everything as we know it changed. Everything changed. In the real world, tensions are often left unresolved. Me and you both know this. Maybe there's an opportunity that we wonder in the back of our mind, what if? It's an opportunity that we feel like passed us by. Or maybe there was a relationship that fell apart. And there's this unresolved tension to that relationship. Or maybe you've lost a loved one or a family member or friend way before their time. You see, in the movies, especially Hallmark movies, there's always a time at the end of the movie where we could take a deep breath and breathe a sigh of relief that everything that happened in the movie, the tension, the conflict, has been resolved and restored. And we long for that in life, but really, in all honesty, in the world in which we live, far and few times do we experience that complete sense of, we live in the midst of tension. And so during this series in Lent, we've been talking about another world as possible, and we've been looking at Mark's gospel. And Mark is the shortest of the four gospels, the four narratives of Jesus's life, his earthly ministry, his death and resurrection. It's the shortest one, and Mark is okay with things being left unresolved. Typically, when we think of plays, we think of five acts in a play. There's the background piece, that's act one, where you get to know the characters, you get to know the story a little bit. We see act two as this rising level of anticipation or conflict. Then in act three, that's the climax of the story. And then in act four, there's this resolving tension where things are starting to fall back into place. And then act five is where we get that chance to take that big, deep breath at the end of a movie. Everything is back in its rightful place. Mark hits the third act of the play, Jesus' death on a cross, on a Roman cross. And then on Easter Sunday morning, we get eight verses in Mark's gospel. Mark drops the mic and leaves the tension thick. I want you to take a look with me, if you will, at Mark's gospel in his last chapter, chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. One thing that I would mention is that in the earliest manuscripts, the text stops at verse 8. Now, there were some other scribes who came after Mark who wanted to pencil in some of that resolution, some of that deep breath that we feel in the fourth and fifth acts of a play. But Mark, in his original manuscript, doesn't give us that resolved tension. So take a look with me, if you will, at Mark chapter 16, verses 1 through 8. It says, Saturday evening, when the Sabbath ended, Mary Magdalene, Mary the mother of James, and Salome went out and purchased burial spices so they could anoint Jesus' body. Very early on Sunday morning, just at sunrise, they went to the tomb. On the way, they were asking each other, "Who will roll away the stone for us from the entrance to the tomb?" But as they arrived, they looked up and saw that the stone, which was very large, had already been rolled aside. When they entered the tomb, they saw a young man clothed in a white robe sitting on the right side. The women were shocked, but the angel said, "Don't be alarmed. You are looking for Jesus of Nazareth who was crucified. He isn't here. He is risen from the dead. Look, this is where they laid his body. Now go and tell his disciples, including Peter, that Jesus is going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there just as he told you before he died." The women fled from the tomb, trembling, bewildered, and they said nothing to anyone because they were too frightened. The word of God for us, the people of God. Thanks be to God. I believe that Mark intentionally leaves the bow off of the end of his gospel narrative. He doesn't want us to breathe that sigh of relief. He knows that there is more to this story. In fact, you'll remember that Mark started his gospel and he said, "This is the beginning of the good news about Jesus Christ, the Messiah, the Son of God. This is the beginning of the good news." And he ends his gospel with this unresolved tension of three women who came to do what only they could think of doing, and that was to give a proper burial to Jesus. They brought spices that they had bought the night before. They came in sorrow and grief. They were asking each other, how are we even going to roll the stone away in front of the tomb? And then there's just this shockwave that goes through the end of Mark's gospel as they see a man, an angel there, who proclaims that Jesus of Nazareth is risen. The stone has been rolled away. Now go and tell Peter and the other disciples in Galilee that Jesus will meet them there. So the good news has started, but it is going to continue to unfold in our lives, in the lives of those first disciples. And Mark is brilliant for ending his gospel that way, for leaving that tension unresolved. So if you feel during this time, during this pandemic, that, you know, things are up in the air, they're crazy, they're not as they should be, yes, yes. And Mark does not try to sidestep that feeling and that emotion that we feel at times during our lives. In fact, he wants us to embrace the chaos and to continue to tell the story of the good news of Jesus, the Messiah, the Son of God. Many of you have been doing that since we've been in quarantine. You've been calling neighbors. You've been checking in on them. You've been going to the grocery store, picking up prescriptions. You've been filling up our food pantry. Many of you brought enough food to fill up the box yesterday as you came and flowered the cross, because the tomb is empty. And there is still hope. And even though the pews are empty this Sunday morning, we're reminded that the tomb is also empty. And we live right now in the fourth act of this play. And of course, there's still tension. We haven't been able to breathe that sigh of relief. But Jesus said that he would come again, that one day he will put everything back in its rightful place. And so as the people of God, we are bearers of hope. We bring hope to a hurting and a broken world. We are continuing to write this story out. And so I want you to think of ways. I want you to be creative and think of ways the same way that folks did 5 and 10 years ago, about ways that you could continue to live out this resurrection faith in a world that's uncertain. In a world that's uncertain, how can we continue to live out this faith, to have this resurrection hope, to believe that another world is possible when everything around us seems to decay and to rust and to die? How can we continue to hope against hope that what Jesus said is true, that he was the first who was resurrected, and that all who believe in him afterwards would ultimately be resurrected as well? So I want to invite you, I'm not going to close with a prayer today, because I want us to embrace that unresolved tension. You are not here in the pews today, but I'm going to invite you out into the world where the church is most effective anyway. So will you follow me and Christ there?
And then there is love that came for us, humbled to a sinner's cross. You broke my shame and sinfulness. You rose again, victorious. And faithfulness none can deny. Through the storm and through the fire, and there is truth that sets Jesus Christ, who lives in me. You are stronger. Sin is broken. You have saved me. It is written, Christ is risen.
Of blessings and assurance. He lives. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen. shines for all to see. Your name.
Was borrowed.